This is my final video on my four-part series posing the question, is the trans ideology a cult or is transgenderism a cult? This last one is on emotional control. So this video is going to be, again, another long one. So I'm going to just jump right into it, stop lollygagging, and get into it. So the first point, number one, manipulate and narrow the range of feelings. Some emotions and or needs are deemed as evil, wrong, or selfish. Doubt is the single most evil emotion any member can experience. Doubting the whole concept of transgenderism, the alleged benefits of medical transition, the integrity and honesty of trans rights activists. Second to that is fear. Fear that inspires hesitation for transitioning. The community at large, like supporting them, believing they're not wrong, and doing what's best for children and teens, believing the studies that support the ideology to not be biased and thorough. Anger. You can't direct your anger at the community, the influencers, the richest members, even the criminals who deserve it, or you might just get canceled. Studious, critical analysis, or otherwise the need to examine information presented by the community. Basically asking questions that the community might not know the answer to, and that like really rattles them. Needing to do a critical analysis is forbidden if it means to probe the weaknesses of the ideology. Being too inquisitive, which is a need for some, is evil. Point two, teach motion-stopping techniques to block the feelings of homesickness, anger, and doubt. I haven't heard of anybody saying anything in regards to, you know, homesickness, so I don't know if there's any techniques being put on to these young people to stop feeling homesick. Like, I don't know if it is or isn't a thing, so. When it comes to doubt and anger, though, the usual technique is to tell the member that they have internalized transphobia, which tends to stop that member from thinking any further and reconsider their feelings. I don't want to prevent myself from being who I really am. I don't want to hate this part of me. I want to be happy, safe, and free from those who've bullied me. If I don't transition, then I'm fearing being me, and I don't want to do that. Basically, internalized transphobia is kind of like internalized transphobia, only in the sense that, well, let's just assume that being trans identified is actually innate, as, you know, being homosexual is innate and something that you cannot control. Having doubts on transition to yours, that would be you're being transphobic to yourself, and you cannot allow yourself to be you, and you is reached by transitioning. Medical transitioning, social transitioning. It is very effective on making these people feel horrible about it. This accusation, or whatever you might call it, further cements their belief in their gender identity. Members of the trans community also tend to give statistics on trans information, like the very minuscule detransition rate, satisfaction from gender-affirming surgery, or, you know, gender mutilation surgery, and how suicide rates seem to reduce after others accept their trans identification and, you know, after transitioning, blah, 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 blah. They also tend to share their sob story on how rough their lives are. It's kind of like, you wouldn't hit a girl with glasses, would you? And this tends to stop doubters from getting upset because they don't want to hurt anyone. They don't want to make someone's life harder than it already is. So basically, it's just guilt tripping. You guilt trip people into stop spewing out things that they don't like. Point number three, make the person feel that the problems are always their own fault, never the leader's or the group's fault. When you're a detransitioner, you are always blamed for transitioning to begin with, and it has nothing to do with them, you know, the community, and their powerful influence over media and politics that had initially inspired you to transition. You're wanting the rest of us to suffer. Stuff like that. Ergo, it's your fault you transitioned. You made a mistake. Don't blame it on us. Stop talking about us. You are harming us. You are putting us more in danger. You're fueling ammunition to the enemy. Stop doing it. Blah. When it comes to trans meds to too cutes, however, who don't experience gender dysphoria, but they're having issues with transitioning, or they're just messing around with gender identities and, you know, making up more as they go, the two cutes will be told that they are attention seekers and ruining the good name of transsexuality. Pretty much, this is why we're not respected. It's then the two cutes' fault that they are suffering and getting bullied for, like, let's say, calling themselves autistic gender. Likewise, when trans meds bemoan about NBs, non-binary people, and the NBs fight back, and once that trans med person starts suffering because of them, it's really their own fault because they're just bigots and transphobes, even though they're trans, and deserve it. Point number four, promote feelings of guilt or unworthiness, such as subpoint A, identity guilt. On the side of transmedicalism, certain members of the trans community will feel guilty for not experiencing gender dysphoria but want to transition. And I'm not saying transmedicalists are not experiencing gender dysphoria. It's people going into a sphere of transmedicalists. And so they would feel guilty for not experiencing gender dysphoria. Non-binary people, for example, is usually the demographic here. They tend to feel guilty for not identifying strictly as male or female, guilt for not being trans enough because this is what the gatekeeping trans meds promote. And that's one of the really big reasons why there's a rift between the two. Cis allies, or just, you know, normal people who are very liberal and think that they're very progressive, will experience guilt and unworthiness in trans discussions and will basically bow down to the power of the trans community or the trans group, wherever it is, if it's like in person, in their place of work, or it's like the forums they attend, etc., etc. Seeing as how that group, that aforementioned group, that trans group is oppressed and victimized, they need to be coddled and respected. Allies know they aren't trusted, and there's this sense of guilt, you know, for being cis, and unworthiness, not belonging to that group because they're cis. When an ally interacts within some trans space because they know they don't fully understand the life experiences of trans people. Subpoint B, you are not living up to your full potential. If you have gender dysphoria and therefore a medical need, if you will, to transition, or in other words, a medical desire to do it, but aren't able to or are unsure, then you won't feel trans enough. And that inspires guilt as well as envy for those who are able to transition and be self-assured and determined in their identity, which is something that I did a little bit. Maybe not as I'm as determined, but more like I saw other people transitioning and getting all the surgeries, and then I would start getting really envious, and that would make me even further like rush into this. I need to transition. I need this double mastectomy. And when you don't have that, you feel really bad about it. And I think in a way there's a sense of shame. Not feeling trans enough means you could be doing so much better. You have so much potential to do more, but you won't do it, or you can't. This makes such members feel guilty, often unworthy of calling themselves trans. Subpoint C, your family is deficient. Perhaps you have family that doesn't support your transition. They don't support trans rights. They don't support child transitioning, blah, blah, blah. And they actively participate in gender critical groups or radical feminism, or they dabbled in it, let's say. You'd feel embarrassed and angry as a kid of these parents, especially if you're still living with them. And because of this, there is an internal sense of guilt, not being good enough because your parents are holding you back from transitioning. And also, it just looks kind of lame. Like, I think there's a sense of, my friend over here has a very supportive family and I don't have that. Oh, I feel so horrible that I don't have what my friend has, that they're so easily able to transition and I'm not. Having that kind of family is just like, it's kind of shameful, really. Subpoint D, your past is suspect. I think your past would only be suspect if you had a history of cooperating with sinful ideas, actions, and people, especially as an ally, considering they have the added caveat of being, you know, cis. If you were, let's say, anti-SJW, or you used to make tranny jokes or whatever have, you know, like, jokes that make trans people the butt of it, but then you changed your ways for the better. There's a chance you could fall back on that, and you should feel guilty for hurting the trans community's feelings. Subpoint E, your affiliations are unwise. Like I've mentioned in, I think it was a second video, you cannot befriend, follow back, or subscribe to persons who are gender critical, Republican, like Orthodox Christian or whatever, even some Jews, or radical feminists. And then also, D-trans radical feminists are extra dangerous. If you are, you are suspicious and very risky. You will be told to drop them, or else. Subpoint F, your thoughts, feelings, and actions are irrelevant or selfish. The ideology is most important, which I've noticed is, like, just the ideology always comes first. Your personal feelings and desires and wants kind of go second. And that's really the only reason why, like, trans people get popular online is because they can all, like, revel in the monolith of, I'm adding to the narrative of I'm victimized and so are the rest of us kind of thing. Any personal feelings of questioning, doubt, scrutiny, like, that's obviously very sinful. So, in that way, everything the members feel, think, and do are irrelevant and selfish unless it boosts the ideology forward in society, like promoting ideas of victimhood. If you aren't being loyal and devoted, you're being selfish, and no one cares about your issues. Subpoint G, social guilt. You will be made to feel guilty if you don't dress the part and pass as the opposite sex in some shape or form. Even though two cutes will declare that there's no right or wrong way to be trans, there's still this very clear, unspoken pressure to dress and act the part. Because, you know, instead of being like, oh, I'm non-binary, and then you just kind of dress how you've always dressed, which, you know, granted some of them do that, but there's still this pressure of, you should be doing something. You should at least, like, wear a little bit of something to pass. And there's still kind of this incentive to get on to cross-sex hormones so you can get a little something out of it. Like, oh, I want my voice to be a little deeper, so I'm gonna get on testosterone for a while and, you know, make it go down. Or, you know, cutting your hair in a certain way. Like, girls, as I've explained before, they often think, oh, well, short hair is guyish, so I'm gonna opt for that. Or almost all the time, the girls, the non-binary girls, won't wear makeup. Although, once they think that they're, like, demi boy sort of deal, they'll be like, oh, well, boys can wear makeup too, so then they'll wear makeup, and that's their justification for it. The reason why I say that is because the gender binary is still a very powerful influence, and this is reflected in the way they present themselves, as I said. And it's very obvious they care about passing because they get giddy whenever they're clocked as the opposite sex. In the too cute community, many members think what the outside world thinks. They just like to tell themselves they believe the contrary. Because if they don't uphold that contrarianism, then they would have to admit that they've failed transition. Subpoint H, historical guilt. Historical guilt is, I would say, it's more in the realm of, a lot of trans rights activists will say, like, oh, trans people have always been around, they've existed since, like, the Roman Empire or something like that. And so every transvestite, every crossdresser, every GNC person who ever lived, who has been harassed, murdered, or assaulted by cis folk throughout history, you automatically, as an ally, get associated with those cis people who harass them and blah, blah, blah. also as well as detransitioners who want to remain supportive because they're also seen as cis. And as an ally, you tend to desperately want retribution for those historical sins. Like, please, please forgive my sins and my historical sins. Please accept me. I have done wrong. Or, you know, as a detransitioner, you're like, oh, well, I went through this, so, like, the history of my life. Oh, man, I'm so bad. I know that if I say any too much about my detransition, then people will start thinking that I'm trying to make the trans community look bad, so I have to not do it. Point five, instill fear, such as fear of point sub point A, thinking independently by cultivating dependency, as in, like, trans friends, supportive family, doctors, gender clinic sort of support, debilitation, which is, like, of boundaries, and your internal foundation of knowledge, you know, biology, deception, dread of separation from the group, and desensitization of, say, bullying others like TERFs. This makes it harder to not only leave, but to think independently. Independent thought means that you lose your support system, and losing that means death. And I feel like this point can really be, like, summarized. But, like, you'll see remnants of it throughout this entire thing. It's just kind of written everywhere. You can't independently think, otherwise you pretty much risk losing everything. And I'll pretty much just get into it as I go. Sub point B, the outside world. Cis people, or normal people, don't understand us, the trans community. Cis people don't have our best interest at heart. Don't trust cis people, only trans people. Trans people know you best. All cis people want to do is harm us. They're likely transphobic and therefore invalidate our existence. It's kind of the thought processes that they'll have, pretty much. I'm only touching on a little bit. That's pretty much kind of just the wide swath of it. Subpoint C, enemies. Anyone you hate is someone you fear. Every single person within the trans community. Well, okay. Almost every single person in the trans community has an irrational fear of radfems, conservatives, Christians, etc., etc. They fear that these parties only seek to harm them physically, emotionally, psychologically. To be fair, they can reasonably fear individuals who seek to harm them, and emphasis on individuals who seek to harm them, because maybe that person is homophobic, because maybe they'll see a man dressing up as a woman, and regardless of his sexual orientation, that'll be seen as like, oh, that's a weak man, or that's a homosexual man, so I'm gonna beat him up, sort of stuff. As well as with, like, a woman who also cross-dresses and looks very boyish too, like, a homophobic person would be like, no, you can't do that, so I'm gonna do some kind of hate crime to this individual. On that front, that makes sense to fear these people, I get it, but to assume that all persons who disagree with your worldview seek to assault you is sheer paranoid delusion. Disagreement also does not equate to violence, but according to the trans community, it does. So, everybody, you know, radfems, conservatives, Christians, I guess some Jewish people as well, if they disagree with the trans ideology, then, oh, well, you're seeking to harm us, and that means all of you are gonna incite violence onto us, and it's just like, it goes into what I said in the video before this one. It's just all paranoia. That's what really fuels it, this fear. Subpoint D, losing one's salvation. To detransition is to mean death, which is loss of friends, loss of a partner or partners, loss of family, but most importantly, loss of the community's support, which is so integral to so many of them. So, especially if that member has little to no cis friends, and has cut off family, and has an active romantic relationship with one or more trans-ID partners, or a, you know, cis ally who's, like, very, very strictly an ally and very progressive, you know, Detransition is also frightening when someone is medically transitioning. They're on cross-sex hormones, or for whatever reason, they stop taking it, but are still identifying as trans. During that time, they experience a lot of despair and anguish, withdrawals, because they're messing around with drugs. Yeah, they're going to go through withdrawals. So they assume means that detransition is terrifying and distancing themselves away from who they feel they really are. Proof is in the feelers. Basically, how that can be summarized. Subpoint E, leaving or being shunned by the group. If you're a member who's built a YouTube channel, a Tumblr blog, an IG thing, I don't know what you'd call them, on being trans, identifying as trans, what the issues are in the trans thing, being commentating on it, whatever have you, or perhaps you've built some sort of business, like a retail around it, like selling binders, packers, and other things that trans people might want, or perhaps you're a genital mutilation surgeon, etc., etc. If you're making money off of it and that you've built something, it's threatening to not only the ego to admit you're wrong, but also to lose everything you've ever built here. You lose money, you could lose your career, you will lose social status. The more of you've invested in the community, the harder it is to leave. Leaving could also mean losing your child if you had been like highly supportive before. Leaving also means loss of future opportunities. For detransitioners, leaving means an expensive endeavor of reversing your transition, where health insurance and many facets of detransition are simply considered cosmetic and therefore need to be paid out of pocket these days. It wasn't necessarily a thing before. I mean, you obviously, that hasn't changed, but with health insurance for trans-identified people, they get it, but then once they detransition, they don't get it. I hope I'm making myself clear. Subpoint F, others' disapproval. Because many, if not all members, come from a socially awkward background, who are desperate to find their tribe and belong, of course they depend heavily on the approval of their fellow trans people. Many members are also... Many, probably if not all of them, are people pleasers and know that everyone is apparently so incredibly sensitive that they'll kill themselves at the drop of a hat upon any such negativity. They would want to diligently validate, trigger warn, and extend support, compassion, and sympathy to other members to prevent such a tragedy from happening. And, you know, they don't want to be at the other end of that. They don't want to be that person who, like, inspired this person to commit. I mean, nobody wants to. So, of course, they don't want to be disapproved of by anybody within. Members fear doing what's best for them, which is all part of the people-pleaser syndrome, lest they make someone else unhappy. And so many members want to be liked, popular, and paid attention to. Hence why they make, you know, their YouTube channels, their Instagram whatevers, and Tumblr blogs on this stuff, and then they do get popular. It's catering to them, ignoring what they need, just so they can have approval. Last subpoint G, historical guilt. Fear of being associated with historical cis sins. As I mentioned in the other historical guilt one, as an ally, you need to show respect, honor, and devotion to the community, you know, bow down to them by preemptively stating you are cisgendered before you state your opinion on anything, all the while knowing you could very well be drowned out or seen as irrelevant, possibly seen as more damaging. Point six. Extreme emotional highs and lows, love bombing and praise one moment and then declaring you're a horrible sinner the next. I think I've either touched on it or I did explain that love bombing is very much there, but let me elaborate a little bit more, I guess. The trans community love bombs new members and trans eggs at, like, when they come in. They're all like, they're so nice to people and they're so understanding, allegedly. They seem like they're very understanding, and they seem very fair, and they seem very conscientious and just you know, overall, they seem to be smart, very intelligent, you know, all these sorts of good things. And yeah, a lot of them are smart and intelligent, but I mean in the sense of, like, they know all exactly what they're talking about, and they're unbiased, and they are very well read on a bunch of different subjects. They know what's going on. They're being mothered by the other trans members, basically. And when you're met with this, it's just like, it feels so magical, it feels so accepting, and it's like, finally, I'm in a place that accepts me for who I am, and they don't fault me for anything. They just accept all my weird quirks, my weird humor, my everything that everybody else outside of this community dislikes. So it's like, yes, oh great, this is fantastic. You know, they're going into it with rose-tinted glasses all the way through. Up until you say something that isn't part of the doctrine, yikes. As I said before, anything that can make one feel doubt or upset at the community and ideology puts everyone on edge. Most of them get angry at you for invalidating them or making them perhaps feel their own doubt on their transition. Some people might be disappointed in this member, or they just straight up just block with no discussion. If you're an ally and maybe you refuse to play the introduce yourself and give us your preferred pronouns game, or you're part of the birthing world and want to use gendered language, then you will be shunned or lose your job for making all the other allies uncomfortable, even though it does not apply to them. Oh, but what about my kid who's trans? Like, it just, it's somebody's opinion. It's not gonna kill you. As an obedient ally, however, you'll be met with all sorts of opportunities and the ability to climb up the corporate ladder. Coworkers will listen to you at meetings because they'll see you as safe. You'll be seen as brave and heroic, kind of, you know, not as brave and stunning as a trans woman, obviously. Like, they're more important, of course. You'll get more referrals to you if you, say, are a surgeon and you can do mastectomies, and then decide to branch out into genital mutilation surgery, etc., etc. Seeing as how Big Pharma loves this honeypot that is transgenderism, yeah, TRAs and allies will spoil you rotten. Next point seven, ritualistic and sometimes public confession of sin. Confession exists, as I've stated before, but it's not ritualistic. It's like they don't get into a room and say, oh, what did everybody do that was bad today? Like, they don't do that. Next point eight, phobia indoctrination, inculcating irrational fears about leaving the group or questioning the leader's authority. Sub point A, no happiness or fulfillment possible outside the group. There is no support or understanding outside of the trans community, as I've established that cis people aren't to be trusted, or at least fully trusted. And because of this, if you were ever to leave, you won't find anyone who could help you. If you doubt the trans ideology, then not only do you put the rest of the community at risk, and that's evil, but also it would automatically mean you're giving up finding slash being who you truly are. You're giving up your truth. You'll never be whole. You'll always feel dysphoric and incomplete. Basically, trans equals happy, not trans equals despair, depression, and suicide ideation, apparently. Sub point B, terrible consequences if you do leave, such as hell, demon possessions, incurable diseases, accidents, suicide, insanity, 10,000 reincarnations. Well, some of those, yes. Pretty much. You will die if you detransition, or if you fundamentally question the grounds that the trans ideology walks on. You will commit suicide. You will become incurably depressed. You will never find love. You'll never be lovable. No one will support you anywhere. You will forever be miserable. You'll never find happiness. As I said, being trans equals happy. Sub point C, shunning of those who leave, fear of being rejected by friends and family. If all your friends are trans, as I've pretty much already established before in other points, and perhaps your family are allies, and or one or two are trans themselves, then you'll have a very hard time with doubt. You don't want to doubt, because then you'll lose favor with your family and friends. If you lose them, you have nothing. And that's just a horrible, ever-present sort of underlying fear within all of it. Detransitioners are the most terrifying prospect the community knows of, although they will not admit it, to the point where they've tried to erase anything about detransitioners, us. Any studies that are made on detransitioners, they frame it in such a way where they only examine those who detransition medically or socially but remain gender dysphoric and desire to transition where possible in their future. Meanwhile, completely overlooking anybody who stated they've discovered that gender transition wasn't for them and don't even seek to retransition. When it comes to acknowledging our existence, they make up reasons as to why we exist, that we were never truly trans, we were cis the entire time, we were just lost and confused with our gender, unlike them, of course. Another wonderful way they acknowledge us is by saying that we're retransitioners, because when we were FTM or MTF, we were truly male slash female, and now we've transitioned to female or male. We never went back because back is impossible. We've already transitioned to one. There is no back. There is only to another one. We've instead become a new type of female or male because in their eyes, we're too botched to be our birth sex. Subpoint D, never a legitimate reason to leave. Those who leave are weak, undisciplined, unspiritual, worldly, brainwashed by family or counselor, or seduced by money, sex, or rock and roll. Those who leave or detransition are deemed as never really trans. This also can apply to trans meds, like Buck Angel, for example, who don't subscribe to the affirmative model. You can't actually be trans if you don't follow all the doctrines all the way through, pretty much. Basically, those who leave are making it worse for the rest of them, rest of the community. If you got into therapy and they somehow didn't affirm your gender identity, or your family swept you up and took you away from all trans influence and you wound up desisting, then you were brainwashed by your family, further confirming to them that conversion therapy is evil. If you've medically transitioned and went the whole nine yards, you're more likely to retransition if you desist, because it's nearly impossible to reverse this. You'll feel alienated, mutilated, and ashamed of your mistakes. And if you don't find the detrans community, you'll either commit suicide, retransition, or at least confess sin and try to keep on the good side of the trans community. You don't want to be condemned as a TERF, as the community is always lamenting how detransitioners wind up TERFy. Last point, threats of harm to ex-member and family. As far as psychological slash emotional harm goes, which is a lot of things that they do, I mean, yeah, they threaten to dox, and I'm not entirely sure how much they actually succeed in doing it, but I wouldn't put it past them, especially in California. There's this ever-looming threat to parents who are gender-critical, radical feminist, Orthodox Christian, Jew especially, that the government will take away the trans-identified child if they don't conform to affirming their gender identity. There's the threat of being called a transphobe, which could ruin their careers, potentially, very likely. There's the threat of losing one's general livelihood, with, for example, like with the Joshua Alcorn thing, when it came to his parents saying, oh, this is horrible, you know, like, it's horrible, I'm lamenting that my son killed himself, like, of course, they're gonna grieve. But, you know, they made it very public that it's like, we miss our son, we loved him, this is a horrible thing that happened. But then what ended up happening is trans rights activists were like, they got so upset at it because, you know, they took it personally. They're like, oh, well, you know what you deserve? You deserve to be doxxed. And so they pretty much like just completely filled her inbox with hate mail, threats of doxing, threat, just a lot of threats, very not safe for work. Outside of that, outside of the family, trans rights activists threatened to harm detransitioners and certain trans meds, especially the more outspoken ones, seeing as though they feed ammunition to rad femmes, gender critical people, you know, the enemy, to further cement the idea that transitioning is evil and should be stopped at all costs. In the case of Keira Bell, for example, a detransitioner who made massive waves in the UK to protect kids and teens from trans regret, she receives threats quite a bit, as the trans community feels threatened by her actions, believing young people's rights to healthcare are compromised because of her, which is not the case. Basically, you're threatening my life because, you know, as I said before, I'm gonna commit suicide at the drop of a hat, so if you make me upset in any single way, well, you deserve to have something very bad happen to you, essentially. So, anyway, so that's it. That's the whole bite model. I think one of the things I don't like about the bite model that I've seen here is that there's so much more about cults that wasn't addressed in it, or at least I couldn't see that it was. Like with paranoia thing, I don't really think that was very specifically apparent, and I had to point it out. And there's also things of like, how do cults recruit people entirely? And that's something kind of important to know, like what's the demographic of people who would go into it. And there is a very specific demographic of people who go into the trans community, you know, transgenderism. And the bite model just doesn't really address that. So I'm thinking maybe in the future I'll make like a video that goes more in a deep dive. Maybe I'm putting it out there, thinking about it. I'll see what I can do, but, yeah, so I really hope this whole series has been enlightening. I hope people, like, maybe learned a thing or two. If there's anything that people want to add to from their own personal experience as an ally or a detransitioner, or even, like, a trans person who supports detransitioners, it would be cool if people came up with their own stories to fill in more details of these points, as I said in my first video, but nobody took it. But anyway, yeah, so that's it for this video. Hopefully I'll see you sooner rather than 2 weeks this time around. Anyway, so goodbye. I'm signing off. Bye.